lies. Okay? We've got the elders who speak, and they've been passing on the knowledge that they taught. And it's down to you, parents, and people on the whole to continue promoting the art form for it to survive. Yeah? Without the website which was created, Pacogem has been around since 1999, and the website was created in 2001, obviously to reach the wider public. The idea behind it when I developed it was to actually promote the hard work being done, as I said, by the elders in the past, current, and what's going to happen in the future. Okay. I'm going to leave you with this message. Okay? It's quite simple. Get involved. That's what it is. Get involved. Be part of the movement. Okay? Steel band is what we call a jumping. You ever heard that term before? You know what is a jumping? Yeah? What is a jumping? Yeah? It's a spirit, isn't it? And when you get involved with steel band and you hear it, you can go away for many years and you come back and you hear that steel band. You feel it. The hair raised on your hands and you feel that music. That's the job. Yeah? Once it captures you, you never get away. All I'm saying is, get involved and get captured. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Robbie. Gerald is coming back. You want to bring the other brother? Wanted to make a point. Okay. I wanted to draw just one point. First of all, Thomas, myself, Stanley Aparicio, we were playing at a club called the Villa de Cesare on the embankment. As a matter of fact, Mr. Gaudini was the agent at that period. And when you talk about the problems we've had with agents in this country, Lord have mercy, and the number of gigs we have done with no money, can't get the money in the end. And those of us from the front, people think that we are part of the organization, so we have to hide and get away. Band men and the musicians of the Caribbean have been through some amazing problems in this country in order to create music. And we were there sent for this job. And Percy was just there playing the pan, and the boss came up. He was a very short man. Can't forget it. I had to look down on him. And he says to me, "What is the music?" I said, "Drums, steel drums, and guitar." He said, drums. I want a band. And we knew by then we didn't pass the audition. We wouldn't get the job. But lo and behold, the sound of the pan magnetized this beautiful woman with her husband. And he was standing there and she was saying, "Oh, Jack, isn't this lovely? You know, we should dine here a little bit more." And we got the job. For 1 year we stayed at the Villa de Cesare. If that woman didn't come along and the pan didn't capture her, it would never happen. There were clubs like the Beach Cone. As a matter of fact, I should begin to write some of the places where we went through in the development of the pan. You would hear about the Ambiance, which was one of the greatest clubs, really, in Bayswater, where the pan used to play. And someone was asking me a question before, because where the pan is said to have started here in Britain is at the Coal Urn, a pub somewhere in Brompton Road. And that's where Russell Henderson, Sterling and others, it was otherwise called the Sunday School. Every Caribbean person, particularly the students, because the student center was down there. On a Sunday, they will head to the Sunday School to find out who come, who dead, who bring rum, or whatever it is. It was a major place. So today we have to document the places that allowed us to develop the steel drum. Last week, there was no place that we used more than town halls. And this Stratford Town Hall, the Lyceum, Porchester Hall, where we were able to make the noise or to play the steel drum. There is a postcard going around where it is said that the steel band first or the first carnival was in Brixton. That's not true. The first carnival was never in Brixton. And this is another thing that in the movement of the steel band across Britain that we have to define those of us who are still alive, when we came, who we met. And there were Africans with us along with that movement. Ginger Johnson and many other people who was not able. I want to now introduce Daniel. You wanted to come and say a word or two before we bring the other gentleman.
Hello, good day everybody. What we're going to do, we're going to invite a member of ITA to come and give you a breakdown of what we do. And then after that, what we'll do is we'll have a break, okay? During the break, we're going to have our steel band playing for us. And any questions on anything that you'd like, you can come and speak to me about. But more importantly, what we'd like you to do is anybody who is interested in playing steel bands, okay, we have a workshop which is on, and that workshop is going to be running for 6 weeks, okay? And what happens is we have availability to run it for 12 weeks. And then at the end of that time, you'll do what you call a little performance. If you feel that you're up to it, you're going to do a little performance, okay? Very simple things, nothing heavy, but the workshop is available for you because that's part of what today is all about. It's also to recruit people for a workshop, okay? So if you've never played before, don't think, oh, I'm not sure if I'll be able to do it, because we're here to teach you that, okay? We're here to teach you that. Right, so what I'm going to do, if she's ready, is introduce you to Bashira, who is part of what you call ITA, to give you a breakdown of who and what this is we are about, okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Greetings everybody, how are you? I can't hear you, how are you? Good. Are you enjoying the day? Good. Even though I've been behind the table, I've been listening and I found it very, very informative. I hope that you have as well. And please take the unique opportunity to register so that you can take advantage of the free workshops. Okay, so who are we? So Intrinsic Tons of Buzzwood, Intrinsic Tons of Buzzwood is an arts-based organisation. It's an organisation that was formed in 2003 and it was set up specifically to offer a professional platform for individuals or groups who come from disadvantaged backgrounds who are not able to access quality arts provisions. So that was the basis of why we set up ITA. What do? We basically offer, as I said, quality arts provisions where we do workshops, seminars. It could be vocal training, learning how to sing, it could be playing steel pans, we've got here today, it could be playing percussion, drums, it could be dance, it could be photography. It's the full creative arts spectrum that we offer training, seminars and workshops in. Who's involved? As I said, it was the founders are myself and Daniel. However, we do have a board, and I'm really, really happy because we've got quite a few members of our board here today, and I'd like to acknowledge them for coming here today and helping out. They're probably behind the scenes, however, I'm still going to call their names. We've got Dennis Brown walking behind you there. We've also got Karen Hilton, who I know is doing registration behind, we actually locked off here. We've also got Mark Anderson, I think he's here as well. We've also got Robert Manning, who's the person that's holding up the registration forms. And myself. There are other members involved as well, but those are members that are here today. And we work with a pool of qualified tutors or professional music practitioners who are able to facilitate quality arts workshops for us. Who do we target? As I mentioned before, we look at targeting disadvantaged individuals. When I say that, I'm talking about individuals that may have real creative talent but are not able to pay for quality workshops, because the going rate for a really good, say, vocal workshop, for example, you're looking at between maybe £60 to £90 an hour, and it goes up. And that's because you're being taught by somebody who is very advanced in their profession and they can demand that kind of money. And what we're trying to say is we're going to create a platform, become the middle person, so to speak, where we can actually create funds, raise funds, where we can pay these professional art practitioners, music specialists to put on our workshops so that individuals still access quality arts provisions but don't have to pay so much money. Our clients. Okay, so basically at the moment we've had work with nursery schools, primary schools and secondary schools. We're also going to be doing work with college pupil referral units and children's homes. So we've been approached by children's homes because they've seen some of our leaflets and they've been interested in what we actually put on as an organisation. So here we're meeting sort of our target group. Where do we operate? Currently we're operating within Lewisham, Hackney, Westminster, Redbridge, Newham and Southwark. We're actually based in South East London in New Cross, so we have an office in New Cross, but we're operating in these areas. Okay, what are the opportunities at IPA? You have access to professional workshops. We take pride in offering you professionals that we know their art form. There's nothing worse than coming to a workshop. I've been on them myself where the person who's facilitating the workshops is not necessarily qualified to actually run the workshop, even though they may have the information. It's important to infuse with the people that you're working with so they have an understanding and an appreciation of your art form and you're able to deliver that to them. We give you structured support. So you come into a workshop setting, you might get one-on-one advice, you might get that within a group setting. From there, you'll go into the workshops where you'll train. From there, you may decide that you want to actually pursue it more sort of long-term in terms of a career. So we can put you in contact with advisors. Also, myself and Daniel, collectively, we've got 30 years experience within the music industry, so we've got a vast network of contacts that we can put you in touch with. Maybe get work placements. Some of what we're doing as well involves acquiring record deals, publishing deals, so it's quite wide. Gateway to live and professional performances. Basically, as you've probably been aware of, with today's launch of the Steel Pans, what's going to happen is that there's going to be a series of workshops attached to this. Once the clients who actually register onto the workshop register and take part in the training sessions, they're actually going to go on a national tour within three specific boroughs in London. So you get an opportunity to actually perform live in front of an audience. And you'll also gain other skills like confidence. You'll be able to meet other team players that are probably at the same level as yourself, and that will also help to nurture you. And also, like I said, the performances are professional. They're going to be led by professional practitioners, people who are versed in their art form. And there's also tutor opportunities available at ITA, as there are volunteering opportunities. You can see some of us here wearing the t-shirts. I know these students actually go to Loxford Science or Technology. Hey, good boys! They're really quiet, but they're not quiet. They're not quiet. Anyway, they're here helping us volunteering. We've got some people at the back wearing the ITA t-shirts. Also, tutor opportunities. There may be some of you sitting in the audience that have musical skills and talents that you think you know you can offer to ITA in terms of structured lessons and workshops. If so, come and speak to myself and I can take down some details from you and give you some more information. And there's also networking opportunities. A lot of us are very, very talented, not just creatively but academically as well. So there is an opportunity to network across the board. Future projects. These are some of the projects that ITA will be doing in the future. Advanced vocal art production. Advanced creative lyric writing. Songwriting for beginners. Video graphics. Music composition and arrangement. Lighting and sound engineering. Stage presentation and dynamics. Creative design and technology. Drama. Steel pan workshops, African drumming workshops. And the long term, one of the long term views for ITA is to actually create our own performing arts academy. This is going to be an academy that ITA is responsible for setting up, and we're going to be looking at recruiting those talented individuals not necessarily coming from disadvantaged background, but that's definitely one of our main target areas, to allow people the platform to come in, to work with professionals, to get the training and to get the access and the support. In terms of the future projects that we're going to offer, I'll just elaborate on one of them for you, which is stage presentation and dynamics. As an artist, it's very important to have a rapport with your audience, pretty much like what I'm doing with you now. Would you agree? So it's important to know how to present yourself on stage, how to talk, how to engage, to get your audience to feel comfortable, you know, so that there's, you know, an energy flowing backwards and forwards. And you have to be dynamic with it. If you look at some of the performers that you really like, in terms of music, maybe even acting, they have a dynamic edge to the way they present themselves, or the way they present their art form, and that's what you engage with, as well as, you know, the lyrics they might be singing, or the melodies they might be singing, or the instrument they might be playing. So here for us, it's very important that you don't just learn your art form, but you know how to deliver your art form as well. Here are some pictures from workshops and projects that we've done at school. Here are the bunch sitting down here from Luxford, where they've been taught by Daniel Steel Pans. Across here is a group of singers that did a performance at an event called Lucian People's Day, which is held in South East London, and it's held every year. Along here we did some work with some nursery school children. We did workshops in singing, in dance, and in percussion.
Hey, good evening, everybody. How's everyone feeling? Okay, I'm going to do a brief talk, really. And first of all, say thank you to Daniel and Bashira for giving my organisation, Mind to Matter, the opportunity to come here today and speak about what we're going to speak about. But even before we go into that, I would like everybody to put their hands together and give a big hand to the elders in here today, namely, you know, the gentleman here who have been speaking, so we can do that now. The gentleman over there, solely because the history of the steel pan and what it represents to us as a people is very great. I don't think we really give it the justice it deserves, because like ITA, that organisation has the saying, something from nothing, we have to realise that there's nothing that we as a people cannot achieve if we don't utilise our skills, or if we utilise our skills. In a situation where we had nothing, we were stripped of everything, all we had access to were things like this, like the brothers talking about dustbins and old pans and stuff like this. And to see that a steel band has made such an impact on the world, that should give us an example of what our abilities are as a people, as a collective of people, what we can achieve if we use our minds. So for that reason, it's a pleasure for me to be here. I'll give you a quick little oversight about what we do. The name of my organization is Mind to Matter. And what Mind to Matter's purpose is to go into schools, universities, and prisons. And we speak with young people from the age of 13 all the way up to 25. And what we speak to these young people about predominantly are African Caribbean young men and women. What we predominantly speak about is how they can access the necessary guidance and facilities within the society to make them become successful.
Bravo is the name I have known him by right through. He's here with us. He's one of the others who have helped to bring Britain and its people forward. And I would like you to give him a big round of applause, please. Bravo, we welcome you this evening. Thank you. He's multi-talented, I may tell you. Now lives in Oxford. But he does little talk outs from the talk. He's still a Trinidadian. So nice.
Hello to everybody. It's a lovely speech by the young man. What's the name again, Elip? Very good speech. Where do we start? I haven't got a script, so I'm going to talk from my head. I don't want to intellectualize anything, you know. Before I start talking, what we got to actually remember today, I mean, when we look around at everybody here, you don't have to go further to see where we come from, you know? So we got to remember tomorrow, 25th of March, is the abolition of the so-called slave trade. That enslaved our forbearance in the past. And we do celebration, not celebration, remembrance all around the country. And we try to celebrate whatever we celebrate with it, like we're alive and we give the world so much. And Africa in itself gave him the world up to today so much. And the system that has enslaved our people is a system that you look around today, and you look around the world and you can see anywhere there are disturbances, they are there. They haven't gone, you know. They failed mankind in a big way. That's the same system that enslaved our people from Africa to the Caribbean, from all around Asia, India, wherever. That's the system. You know, they build their own and kings and queens and presidents and prime ministers and look around and you can see them there, they still they haven't left. And why I start talking about that, the reason why I start talking about that is because it takes me right back to the steel pan. Now, the steel pan has a strong history. And the history of the steel pan men, because of our past in colonial time and British rule, when we was fighting and resisting and trying to get our own song. It was with the steel pan, it went back to the same slave time. So therefore the steel pan got its roots in the slavery experience in the Caribbean.
Whenever Slee took over, and he would tell you his own little history as the band leader from another brother who died, we remember that well. And then Eversley went into the Commonwealth Institute where he did a lot of work. And it's nice to know that you're still there, my brother. And I last saw him doing a mighty thing at the Victorian Albert Museum. Give him a big round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you. I'd like to talk to you about my experience as a manager of the Metro Music Orchestra. But before, I want to take you back a bit further back than that, when I first started to play piano. My parents came from, well, left Trinidad in 1960 and left six children in Trinidad to come to America for a better life. The youngest was 7 months old, my younger sister. And they came to England and they had me, and from the age of about 5-6 years of age, I mean, I was living in Notting Hill, born and grown in Notting Hill, and I heard I was living around the steel pan, and it just captivated me. It was just something that, you know, I just couldn't, the sound, just the vibe, I think we were talking about the vibrations of the steel pan just captivated me, and I always wanted to play. But in those days, it wasn't as easy to play as it is now. There wasn't no workshops and no bands you could just go and join. So you just had to hang around these older guys playing. And I mean, just people like, I heard about people like Forsyth, people like Eman Ford, who were just 10 minutes ago. And I just wanted to play pan. And I think it was about the age of about 9. I think I was 9 when I started to play. Well, I went down to Akron Road. you know Akron Road. And I started to, you know, get involved in the pan. And my parents were absolutely mad. They were crazy because at that time, you know, they came from a time where if you was a pan man, then you was no good. And it was like the end of the world. It was like, well, what did we do? You know, we raised him wrong. What happened? Why is he in this team? You know, he was never in this team. Why was it? And I get what we call cutters, a lot of licks for playing pan. A lot of licks. And being there's nobody else in my family at that time who was playing pan or even in carnival. They were Pentecostal Baptists. They didn't want nothing to do with pan at all. So they were like, well, how come I was involved in this team? What, you know, what happened to me? You know, am I sick or? They couldn't understand it. And I took the licks, for a good few years, till I was big enough not to get next number one. I was still in the band. And then a guy by the name of Len Bosey Sharp came over, I think it was 1974, 75,